Hello, and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host, Bryan. We're going to finish up today with a special selection. That's where one of you tell me exactly what I need to check out. Today's comes at us from Scott. It says, I'd like to request this piece, The Sound of Someone You Love Who's Going Away and It Doesn't Matter, by the English band Penguin Cafe Orchestra. It's from their first album released in 1976. I look forward to the reaction. I'm going to be honest. When I heard the title of this song, and even to a lesser extent, the band name, I was expecting indie rock, modern indie rock. I was not expecting to find out that it's from 76. So we got an 12 minute song here. Pause the video, get some water, get a light snack, and get comfy. We're in for a ride. Let's go. Yeah, very warm, comfy chord progression right here. The panning heavy left is weird. The bass on the right side is a nice complement, and I do like having some clarity to the bass line. It's very weightless. A lot of joy in this song. Like, I'm picturing, you know, these big green hills and just rolling down them. Having a picnic out on a sunny day. Some really fun syncopation going on in the bass, providing a little bit of rhythmic contrast to what the guitars are doing. That sparse violin comes in for a little bit, leaves, comes back. I like how it adds a new timbre, and we get so used to that foundational stuff that the whole song has been comprised of, having this nice warm violin come in against the brightness of everything else. Interested where this is going. This cleans right back up. Little elements of layering. Almost looks like we have a toy piano, maybe, on the right. Could also be a xylophone, actually. Has a nice, warm wooden block funkiness to it. I think this is the first time the left guitar has really changed up what they're doing, and it happens to line up with what the cello's doing.
Thank you.
That's a cool sound. So we're introducing a little bit more, not dissonance, but lack of harmony. Very playful. These heavily syncopated sections are killing me. So, that was interesting. I have an idea of what's going on here, but it took me a while to form it, and I think this is a fantastic slow burn. But I don't think I would have gotten it without... Well, I don't even know if I'm right. Here I am being a bit pretentious. Yeah, I've already got this. This is in the bag. No, what I think is heavily based off the song title. So there's that. Without the song title, I don't know that I would have any understanding of what's going on musically other than exactly what's on the surface, what's presented to me. And I want to go over that first before we dive into what it might mean, because there are some really cool things going on here. First of all, we have this concept of yin and yang, light and dark, harmony and chaos. And they jump back and forth between these two ideas a couple of times. I think there's two moments of chaos and then three moments of harmony. We start on harmony, we end on harmony, and we sort of zigzag between them. So what's interesting here is that there is never really a clear line, I would say, of when we've transitioned from one idea to the next. And this is going to play a huge role later on when I start digging into some of the meaning here. It's usually one instrument that begins to work within the next idea, and then other instruments follow them. Sort of like a staggered movement between concepts. And I love that. It is such an interesting way to go about writing specific sections. And it does a huge job of changing the feel of a song. Take your favorite standard structured song, your verse, chorus idea. And instead of at the last bar of the verse going into the chorus, instead of having a strict stop there, where all the instruments are now just into that next section, we have gone from the verse into the chorus. Imagine a bar prior, or two bars prior, still in the verse section, the guitar shifts to the chorus riff. And then one bar until the chorus, the drum shifts into the chorus pattern. And then when we hit the bar, we're into the chorus. Now the vocalist is singing the chorus section, and a bar after already being in the chorus, we are now, the bass has finally caught up and has begun to play the bass riff for the chorus. And you have this staggered movement. It blurs the line a bit. And first of all, we get to hear a bunch of really cool ideas overlapping each other. What would it sound like if the, you know, the rhythm guitar chord progression from the chorus were played during the verse? You know, what if we played some of the bass line, the heavily syncopated bass line from the verse in the chorus? And you get to hear these different combinations of ideas. But it also blurs the line between verse and chorus so that you can't really create a strict moment of when one becomes the next other than after, you know, a bar in, once everybody has moved to this new idea. But the chorus, does it start when the vocalist starts singing the lyrics from the chorus? If so, we have a variation on the chorus where the bass is still playing the verse line for a bar. You know, it does it start when the drum does a fill into the new idea? Well, now our chorus starts two bars before the vocalist starts. So it introduces some interesting ideas as far as analyzing structure goes. But for a listener, like I said, you get to hear all these different ideas. And it makes the song feel more fluid. You don't have these rigid moments of verse and then chorus. And it can do a lot for making a song feel extremely cohesive and singular in process, rather than feeling like a segment or a string of segments tied together with very similar ideas between them. That would be the idea that ties it all together. The string that ties the song together is that they're all utilizing similar chord structures or similar rhythms or something, but the structure of the song is very segmented. So this is an interesting way to create parts of the song that are at ends with each other, but still have the song feel cohesive. You allow them to bleed into each other, so you get these wonderful blurred transitions, these extended transitions between ideas. And that's just musically on paper. Like I said, thematically, you know, we're going to get into that when I touch on theme. But I think it's very interesting what this applies to and how I heard it. I have to touch on the melody, though. They use a lot of counterpoint. At one time, we have at least four lines going, two of which are melody, although I believe they had three melody lines. At one point in time, it was the oddity. Usually it was two melody lines. We have a left panned guitar, a right panned bass. The bass is usually has some really nice bass licks, but is not doing anything melodic. Not to put down the bass. Like I said, there are some really interesting licks that the bass is doing. And then the bassist also provides some rhythmic counter rhythms to what the guitar is doing at the beginning. The bass quickly gets drowned out as we have more and more instruments put in, though, unfortunately. I saw there was a remaster, 2008 digital remaster. I may end up going and checking that one out and seeing if maybe they boost the bass a little bit. There are some elements, like I said, where we have the guitar and the xylophone and the violin and the cello. And it gets to be a bit much for the bass, who's already a bit washed out even at the beginning. We also have a xylophone, I believe, that's panned right. I'm not 100% certain on that. It has this hollow wooden ringing to it. So it makes me want to think it's a xylophone, but it also has some bright plunkiness to it that kind of reminds me of a toy piano or a glockenspiel. And I'm just not sure what that instrument is that's right panned that tends to be playing in opposition or sometimes within the guitar playing that's left panned. I think at the beginning I actually called it a guitar, and it was about a minute or two in once the volume has risen a bit, because we did start out with a fade-in, that I realized it was not a guitar. If it is, it's got some interesting effects on it. But we have that instrument, which I said is playing within and around the left guitar. And I think it's really interesting when you listen to the two of them, especially at the very beginning, within the first minute or two, I would say. Listen to the rhythmic structure in the right panned instrument versus the guitar and see how often they overlap with some of the guitar's accented notes while it's playing its triads. And when it isn't, and when it's playing against it, and it sort of fluidly moves in between this idea of augmenting the rhythmic structure that the guitar is playing while also syncopating against it, providing some rhythmic contrast to what the guitar is doing. And it is just, it's really interesting to see how fluidly it moves between these two ideas. And again, I think it works thematically. I'm going to touch on it later, but just even listening to just that one section, not even hearing the whole song, not knowing any of the theme, not knowing the title track, it is a joy to hear the way rhythm is utilized just between those two instruments. And rhythm is highly important. We'll see later on when the violin and cello come in, rhythms are something that are hyper-focused almost in some of these sections, especially once we reach some of the more dissonant sections where rhythm becomes almost the key aspect, because the notes themselves are just going for dissonance. The notes themselves aren't as important as the textures that they're creating, and the rhythm becomes the core aspect of the writing at that point. And then we bring in violin and cello, and we hear these beautiful lines. I think I said something about reminds me of summer and picnics and rolling down hills, green hills and stuff like that. And there's this bright warmth to it between the guitars and what I think is a xylophone, really bringing some brightness and levity to it. And then the strings giving that warm width that the song really needs. The two higher pitched instruments, the guitar and the xylophone, they are bright, but they're a bit narrow. They can't carry the song with the width it needs, and the strings do a fantastic job of that. So we have these sort of moving between sparser sections with just the two panned instruments, and then bringing in the string section to layer it on a little bit, provide some weight, provide some warmth and lower end stuff. And I honestly thought that was going to be the whole song. We moved back and forth between that two or three times, I think. And while I enjoyed it, it was nice to listen to. It's very pleasant. I like some of their melody lines. I love their use of harmony. They just write gorgeous, you know, traditionally gorgeous music. I think they are just masters of making strong melody lines and even counterpoint. Like I said, there's quite a few sections where there are two melody lines moving at the same time. And while I do think that some moments, probably intentionally, the melody kind of overlaps each other a little bit too much, and it kind of creates a bit of chaos, a little bit of busyness, over-busyness, for the most part, their writing is very harmonious, and all of their melody lines are quite aware of each other, and they're not overstepping, playing too many notes in a single beat, or playing the wrong notes to create some bad tension rather than some spicy tension. Spicy tension. Oh, it's a good band name. I just don't know what genre that would be for. I can't imagine a metal band, a black metal band called Spicy Tension. Maybe like a jazz fusion though? Anyways, I'm getting off topic. So yeah, they do a fantastic job of just building these sound floors and then putting amazing melody writing on top of it. Then we shift into the avant-garde aspect, where we incorporate a ton of dissonance, rhythmic playfulness in an effort to create tension through rhythmic disassociation, where we can't tell the time signature maybe, or where it sounds like two instruments are trying to play at the same time and they're just out of sync. I swear some of these times they were 16th notes out. And instead of getting a nice sting, just like a bop, we get ba-da. We get this like so close. They should have played together and they didn't. And it's an isolated hit. So it's this entire idea of being out of sync. The harmonies are not in sync. It's creating dissonance. It's creating tension. It's creating these strained musical textures. Our rhythms are out of sync. We have instruments that should be playing together but aren't. We have these massive pockets of emptiness, lots of rest, 2-3 beats at a time, where prior we didn't have even a half of a beat of silence. It is the complete opposite of what we just listened to. It is chaotic in every sense. Not chaotic like Dillinger Escape Plan, where there's too much going on at one time, but chaos in the fact that there is no harmony. Or discord? Discord's the opposite of harmony, isn't it? I think that's what I want. Not chaos, discord. Basically, anything that we did prior, we're taking the opposite of it. We filled in space from beginning to end. We're going to have pockets of rest here. All the instruments were properly aware of each other, made sure that their notes were, nice. The note relationships were great. They were providing harmonious textures, no dissonance. The instruments were aware time-wise. Complete opposite. Notes, who cares what notes you're playing? The more tension, the better. If you're not playing right on time with someone else, that's fine too. It's just the complete opposite. And I think it works on an artistic level. I do. Because like I said, when we get into theme, I think it all works to tell the story of the song. On its own, it's interesting. I don't think it adds anything to the song. It provides contrast, of course, but I don't think the contrasting elements provide anything of positive element to the song itself. It just provides contrast for contrast's sake. So if I was listening to this and someone did not tell me the title, I don't think I would have enjoyed those elements as much. The song in isolation, in a vacuum, I don't think benefits from the avant-garde sections. You know, I've brought that up before. Outside of the theme, this section doesn't work. I've talked about songs where I'll say something like, on an artistic level, I really appreciate it, but on a musical level, I don't get it, it's not for me kind of idea. And it makes me wonder, how far can we divorce a work of art from its intentions before we are talking about something that doesn't exist? Is me analyzing this song without its title worth talking about because the song has a title? There is no instance of this other than maybe a demo where this song is titleless. There are situations where it could be perceived that way. Like I said, if someone just played this for me randomly off the street and never told me the title, but I don't know. That's an interesting question. Is it worth talking about this strictly in the vacuum of being music without concepts of theme or title? I don't know. That's a big question for this short video. But it's got my brain gears rolling. But let's get into some theme, because I think I've explored everything music-wise. So the title of the song is The Sound of Someone Who You Love Who's Going Away, and It Doesn't Matter. I've tried to wrap my mind around what this means. So you love somebody and they're leaving you. That right there is usually cause for heartbreak or sorrow or anger or any other sort of negative emotions. This is a situation most people do not want to be in, whether it's a family member or a friend or a partner. It really doesn't matter. If you love somebody, the last thing you want to do is, you know, not have them in your life anymore. For whatever reason, it doesn't really say what it means by going away. It could be that they passed. It could be that they're ending the friendship or relationship, that they're walking out, whatever. It doesn't really imply what going away means. But then it finishes the sentence with, and it doesn't matter. And I'm trying to figure out what a situation would be where you love someone and don't care if they're still in your life. That seems so backwards to me. But here's where my brain took it as a modern day millennial, not as someone who was maybe in their 20s or 30s in mid to late 70s. I don't remember. What did you say, 74? 76. So mid 70s. To me, there's a bit of sarcasm in there. And I think this song is about the mask and what's beneath. The bright, cheery, harmonious sections are more so the elements of what is presented. You're leaving me, and that's fine. I don't care. It doesn't matter. But that is a front for what's actually happening on the inside. And it's those cracks in the mask, those moments when the pain and sorrow are too strong to hide, or it's possibly just, an auditory showcase of what's happening beneath the surface. But this event in this person's life is causing them turmoil. And they're just trying not to present it. And I like how the song uses these smooth transitions, because there isn't just a moment when you're presenting yourself to be fine, and then the next moment you're, you know, in tears or, you know, whatever, where you are, you know, physically showing that you're not happy with what has happened in your life. It is this subtle movement. First, the guitars start to break, right? And they start playing around with dissonance. And then the violin starts to step on the cello's toes as far as, rhythmic ideas go. And then, you know, the bass might stop playing and might start more sporadically. And it's this slow breakdown of this wall before we enter complete chaos, when you have lost the function to support this social mask, and when what you're actually feeling is what is being shown. And then, of course, you find a way to put the mask back on. You can reconstruct it. And I'm not quite sure how that fits along lines of this storyline that I've, privy to listen to. But I do think it's interesting that the second avant-garde section comes a lot quicker in the song than the first one did. Instead of, 5 or 6 minutes into the song, it was 1 or 2 before he switched back. And it shows that the mask has cracked, and something that is cracked cannot be whole again. It will fracture more easily. And I love that idea. I think it's fantastic. It's also this blending idea of not having a strict moment of when we shift from the avant-garde to the more harmonious classic style, classical composition, is that it too is very fluid, with some instruments restoring to that harmonious playing before others have. And it's this slow stitching back together of the facade. It's really interesting to see these elements done this way and kind of tell this tale. And I think that's, it's great. I've talked about in the past how I love thematic, musically thematic works that find ways to utilize everyday tools of music composition and apply aspects to storytelling to them. And this is no different, assuming I'm reading into this correctly. because I don't, if they weren't going for sort of a sarcastic idea, which I don't know how modern of a take that is, as someone who didn't live in the 70s, I don't know how widespread sarcasm was. It seems to be a second language for at least my generation. I don't think I've met many millennials that don't use sarcasm in every other sentence. it's just what we grew up with. So it's also how I read this. It is my bias in reading this. When I see the statement, I read it dripping in sarcasm. But if that's not how it is, I am kind of intrigued about what it means then. And it also kind of destroys a lot of what I think the theme of the song is and the story that it's telling. So in that case, those are my thoughts. This is where you guys come in, though. Let me know what's going on. If you enjoyed this or not, of course, let me know if you need to explore more of this. You just enjoyed it that much. If you have any context into this, though, I am all ears. This was an interesting listen. I really enjoy it on an artistic level. Like I mentioned, I love when music is thematically cohesive. It is just, that is my bread and butter right there. I love listening to music like that. But if I'm completely wrong, I'd definitely like to know what the actual intended context of this track is. And if you have that information, please post it in the comments. Above the comments section, there's a description box and there's a link for Linktree, which will take you to a menu with everything related to the channel. Twitter, Discord, Patreon, email, whatever. It's all in there. Above that, if you could, like, subscribe, and ring the bell. I'll be back tomorrow, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 10 p.m. UTC, with whatever we're doing tomorrow. I'm kidding. We've got more niche subgenres coming, and then also a special selection. All right, until next time, remember to be critical but not cynical of the music you listen to, and have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening whenever you choose to watch my videos.